He's a new face, and we know he can punch, but can he make his name in the light welterweight division? This man was a mystery in this country, but after just one spectacular win, his name was on everyone's lips. Samuel Malinga was the South African prospect of the year. But Ted Bami looks another fighter on the up. It's intriguing. Two emerging light welterweights. Ted Bami tries to add another international name to his record, but Samuel Malinga might be the best he's yet faced. It's top of the bill, live from the Pavilions in Plymouth. He's come from nowhere, but can Bami now make an impact on the very best in this light welterweight division? Nicky Piper's with us tonight. Nicky, let's start with the big three ahead of him, at least in Britain. Is he on the tail of those fellas now?
Yeah, he's improving all the time. You know, we've got Ricky Hatton, Eamon McGee, Junior Witter, three tremendously world-class fighters there. But this man is improving, and he can catch them. But Malinga tonight is a tough, tough opponent.
Looks like being an excellent matchup here in Plymouth. Certainly, Bami is a man who's emerging as something of a sharp operator. Bit of a stylist. But he has been cutting it fine once or twice.
Tonight, I'm going to be taking a shortcut to the top.
An intriguing figure in so many ways, an exotic background. We might say the same about the man who will start us off in action here first tonight, as Craig Slater explains. Like
a rolling stone. Adrian Stone's back in Plymouth, and boxing's pilgrim father's ready to profit from his American adventure.
It's been a great experience for me to go over to the United States, man. I've learned a lot, picked up a lot of experience now. Now that I've come of the age of 32, coming back home to retire, basically.
Stateside, Stone mixed with the best, pushing Vernon Forrest hard and gaining valuable experience against Shane Mosley.
I fought Vernon Forrest, Sugar Shane Mosley. Yeah, you know, I won 11 rounds with Vernon Forrest, and yeah, that was great experience. When it comes to dollars, everyone knows America's a place, you know.
And this genuine puncher aims to wreak havoc on the domestic light middleweight scene.
And that is a really good win for Adrian Stone.
I feel like I'm still an exciting fighter. You know, I'm coming, you know, I'm getting older as time goes on. But I'm still pretty much an exciting fighter. I don't go in there and just waste a lot of shots. I do go in there and I do pick my shots.
He does look to have a fight all the time, and that's what we've been trying to sort of steady him up a bit, you know. And everything you do, he wants to come back with another shot and another shot.
The gangly Farai Musllwa blocks his path, but Stone knows he can't afford to be sidetracked now. And he's convinced a new Stone Age begins tonight.
But no matter whether it's a stoppage, whether it goes a distance, I just want to get the W. That's it.
Great to have him back, Nicky. You know, he was so close to the big breakthrough at welterweight. Now at light middleweight, they're talking up a meeting with Sergio Martinez, who saw off Richard Williams in an upset here recently. Well, are they right to be ambitious about Stone?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, Stone's quality. To be in with Mosley and Vernon Forrest, what a tremendous, you know, thing to do for your career. But this man is quality. He's a really good puncher, doesn't waste shots. He's a typical American style, but is up there with the Sergio Martinez of the world.
The opponent, Farai Musllwa, is well known here already. You may have seen him with us on Sky Sports last October, challenging James Hare for the Commonwealth welterweight title.
Yes.
Were your impressions of him that night?
Well, he's got the height to move up a weight, that's for sure. But he was awkward to get to, but eventually Hare just found him and was putting him down with jabs eventually. And his chin didn't look that strong. And if he's going to get caught by Stone, there's no way he'll stand.
It must be said, Nicky, that does not augur well for him here tonight.
No, it doesn't. He was awkward to get to, and Hare is very sharp. But it's a yardstick to measure Stone by. What's he got left this
He'll try and move away from Stone, won't he, as much as possible? Well, and make him work.
Yeah, he certainly won't mix it with Adrian Stone, that's for sure. But he'll be awkward to get to. We don't expect him to win, but it's a show of Adrian Stone. How good is he still? And let's see what he has to offer.
I think it's only fair to say that for Musllwa, Stone would be the biggest and best name on his record so far. But what of Stone? It's a chance for him to show us that there is plenty left here. We're all set in Plymouth. Big crowd here tonight. Commentary from Glenn McCrory and Ian Dark. Master of Ceremonies, John MacDonald.
Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening and welcome along to the Pavilions here in a beautiful city of Plymouth. For tonight's championship boxing, proudly presented by Barry Hearn for Ringside Boxing Promotions in association with Chris Sanigar, Prince Promotions and Matchroom Sport. All sponsored here by PokerMillion.com for a great game of online poker. And sponsored also by the Plymouth Evening Herald. All the officials have been appointed by the British Boxing Board of Control here present with us at ringside. Steward in charge, Ken Honeyball, joined by the Boxing Board Secretary, Simon Block, and our inspectors, Di Corp, Fred Little, Phil Waits, and Julian Courtney. Our three medical officers, Dr. Fitzgerald, Dr. Redmond, and Dr. Naismith. So let's get the action underway, sports fans. This is 8 rounds international light middleweight contest. Introducing to you, firstly, and fighting out of the red corner wearing the multicolored trunks, weighing in at 11 stone, 1 pound, 15 ounces. Bringing a 17 fight record, 13 wins, 10 inside the scheduled distance, and just 4 defeats. From Zimbabwe, where he is known as the Porcupine, Farai Musllwa. And now, across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing the black trunks, weighing in at 11 stone and 8 ounces, with a 38 fight record, 32 wins, 25 inside the scheduled distance, 4 losses and 1 draw. Coming to the ring as the former IBO light middleweight champion of the world from Bristol, Adrian. Time for the bell is John Lee, and referee in charge of the action is Rob Wallace. This is 8 3-minute rounds.
Ready. You know the rules and regulations. Abide my commands at all times. Shake hands. Good luck.
Interesting this. There's Adrian Stone, a real tough nut, who learned his trade in the gyms of the United States and has been in with Vernon Forrest and Sugar Shane Mosley, two of the very best welterweights of the modern era. Against him, Farai Musllwa from Zimbabwe, stopped by James Hare in a Commonwealth welterweight title fight, and again when he returned to Britain by the Ghanaian southpaw, Joshua Akeni. He starts a big underdog here against Stone, who spent a lot of his time working around the gyms of Paterson, New Jersey, which used to be the home of the legendary Reuben Hurricane Carter. Stone, though, 32 now. Long 18-month break after being beaten in 3 by Sugar Shane Mosley. This is his third fight back. Not really tested on the comeback so far. And back in the arena, by the way, the Plymouth Pavilions here, where he beat Joe Townsley over 12 rounds in an IBO light middleweight title fight a couple of years back. Crowd obviously remember that. They gave him a big reception. Stone with the shaven skull. Fast start from Musllwa.
Well, Musllwa really whipping in his left hooks, getting a bit of leverage off this very tall frame.
Gangling fighter, this Musllwa. But he looked fragile and, frankly, a bit chinny when he fought James Hare, the excellent stylist from Huddersfield. Stone dwarfed by the Zimbabwean here.
Musllwa, we're coming off a good run, so he might have some confidence.
Good left hook from Stone there, and again, picks the punch as well. Another chopping right hand from Musllwa, who's really letting the leather flow in this first round. I don't think Adrian Stone quite expected this.
Well, it's a very confident start for Musllwa. He really is looking to get the big shots on.
Won 13, lost 4 so far, Musllwa. 10 stoppages in those 13 wins, though.
He's just landed another big, long right hand under the jaw of Stone.
Stone looked as good as anything around in Britain when he came to these shores before, for a while, just before the Shane Mosley fight. In fact, he looked only just behind the top world level, didn't he, at that time?
He really did. But that break after Mosley fight should have done him some good, just to freshen up and come back focused.
Just a little bit worried in that interview before the fight. You heard him starting talking about retirement.
That's right, coming back home to retire, which is often a bad sign when you're thinking about that.
Been busy in this first round, Musllwa, despite those two good left hooks from Stone. That's a nice right hand as well. This might get interesting. Just being told by some people with the Musllwa camp that he's put on some natural weight since he lost a hair. They think he's improved a lot and worked hard since that defeat. It was a good opening round for him, Glenn.
Well, he does look much a bigger man than he was against James Hay, and threw some good shots, the right hand especially. And we saw it there, that long right hand from that very tall frame.
So will Stone have his work cut out here? Most people were expecting an early stoppage for him tonight. Now, this will be the toughest test, I think, since he's come back to the ring. Two fairly facile stoppages so far. Heavily outreached here, and maybe outspeeded too by this gangling man from Zimbabwe who calls himself the Porcupine. Is that something to do with his hairstyle, do you think, Glenn?
Can't think of anything else it would be. But Stone's got to try and find his way inside those long arms, which might not be that easy.
Stone might have to be quite cute here. He might have to try and employ raiding tactics. Right hand at the moment, he looks like he needs a step ladder to get near to this fellow. Missing a lot, Musllwa there.
Stone's a good puncher, solid fighter, and you'd think if he can just start getting through shots, they'll have an impact.
Fast left hook, crowd like that. Some of them off their seats in the back of the arena here. I think there should be more big boxing down in Plymouth. There's usually a rattling good atmosphere when you come down here.
The left hook of Stone starting to get through.
And he's making Musllwa miss with more as well, significantly.
He's also drawing Musllwa into his sort of fight.
More accurate close in, Stone. He's learned a lot in those American gyms, and frankly, I think that more British fighters should go to America and seek that kind of work, don't you?
I do, I definitely agree with that. I think you need it. It's very tough and very competitive in the American gyms.
Just puts that extra bit of polish on and know-how. This is good from Stone in round two. He's picking the punch as well, getting closer.
Still looking for that left, just falling short with it that time, Stone.
Getting his gloves up well, blocking a lot. Stone, who can fight at welterweight all night middle, big left hook again from him, rocked back the head of Musllwa. Good body shots as well. He was fizzing at the start, this man from Zimbabwe, but I fancy Stone's knocked a bit of it out of him here.
Well, he's still trying to stay in close with Stone, not use that high, use that reach and the leverage that he was doing so well in the opening round.
Now the left hook, he likes that shot, and he's enjoying punching upwards to land it as well. Then there was a right round the side. Musllwa might find this hard because he's a fair old dig, Stone, nothing wrong with that. Second round, Adrian Stone looked like the high-class operator we know. He picked the punches very well, didn't he?
Yes, he did. He just started to come through, get into range and fight his sort of fight. And the left hook was very, very good. He was getting inside the arms, couldn't get caught and come back with some good shots himself.
Third round, black trunks of the shaven skull. Predator, as he's known, Adrian Stone, originally from Bristol, but sometimes out of Paterson, New Jersey as well, but back facing himself in Britain now. That might be interesting news for Takaloo, Richard Williams, and British champion Jamie Moore, who's fast improving. Stone wants him in the same ring, although they're from rival promotional camps. Can't see it at the moment, frankly. Another target could be Sergio Martinez, the bloke who beat Richard Williams recently. That would be an interesting fight for Stone. How much ambition does he still have left? That's a bit of a question at 32. Oh, very well worked. Right to body, right to head from Stone, who's got a lot of good wins on his record. Beating like people like Johnny Duplessis, Daryl Lattimore, Roger Turner, Michael Carruth, retired him, Jeff McCreesh, Derek Roach, Joe Townsley. It's a good ledger he's got, Stone.
And he's working well now, finding the uppercut and then the right hand.
Looks like he means it, doesn't he, too?
Yeah, he's really warmed up quickly into this. Style of Musllwa is also suiting him.
Like arm punches from the Zimbabwean at the moment as well. Tended to throw long punches from a wide stance when we saw him against Ayers. Again, menacing looking work from Stone.
Musllwa. You know, his punch resistance a lot better than it looked against James Hare.
Well, I think he's improved since then, but Stone is a tough ask for anybody who's not at the highest level. Musllwa is only 23, 9 years younger than Stone. Short, straight punches from Stone. Again, the right hand. I think he's just so much stronger. Uppercut as well. And again, one almost after the bell. And once again, the Zimbabweans corner then rush out. Stone goes back to the wrong corner. It's chaos at the end of every round. They're very, very anxious to get Musllwa back to the corner, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. They've got to work on their man back in the corner, but he's fighting the wrong fight, Musllwa.
Let's have a look at the British light middleweight scene. Takaloo at the top there, Richard Williams, Jamie Moore, Adrian Stone. He'd say he's better than all of them, and quite a few people might agree as well. Michael Jones there at five. He certainly mixed at a higher level than any of the guys above him, much higher.
Much higher, but you know, he's had that break from the ring after the Musllwa fight, just one fight since, so he needs to build it up and work his way. You know, the proof is in the fighting and the results that he gets now.
he even talks with a New Jersey accent, doesn't he?
Yeah, he's got a bit of an accent. But it's good work from him inside.
Here we go with the fourth round of this one. Due to go eight, by the way. Non-title fight. Nothing wrong with that. Stone looking to work his way back towards some kind of championship chance. No reason at all why it shouldn't arrive for him either. What can Musllwa do about it? Working behind the jab at the range, finding pitter-pat kind of jabs. More showy than anything. Good right cross from him, Mike.
Well, I think that's what Musllwa needs to throw more of. It was the right hand in the first round that he's picking Stone up with. But from a distance, he needs to keep the distance between them both.
Now, this Adrian Stone is a real fighting man. He fought for five rounds against Vernon Forrest with a broken jaw before Forrest stopped him. Musllwa, but not with any real intention. It's not finding the target, it's just a range finder, isn't it?
Yeah, I don't think he's got the strength in that jab to really hurt Stone. Stone's just walking through it. He's got the extra physical strength.
Musllwa doesn't look as if he has enough of a dig to make Stone think about walking forward and getting in range. And there's the uppercut from Stone, who shows a fair old repertoire. He may not be quite as good as he was maybe 3 or 4 years back, but he's still pretty good. Oh, that right hand has knocked everything out of Musllwa, who collapses back, lands on his backside by the ropes, and might do well to get past this moment. Knocked out, didn't think he could recover from that. Stone's done it again, fourth round. He's still around, all right. This man is a threat to any 11 stone fighter and any 10 and a half stone fighter around in this country and in a few other countries as well.
And look at the crowd, Ian. They really loved that, didn't they? It was a tremendous punch from Stone. Really was a big right hand. He kept the pressure on so well, and it's good to have him back, and good to have him back in that sort of form.
It is. I think it's an exciting addition to the British scene, isn't it?
Well, it's a good scene. There's some good fighters there. And he needs to mix it up with those guys, see who's the best.
I'd love to see it, but will we? Is he going to fight Takalu?
Well,
are they going to? Takalu's people aren't going to let him in with Stone.
But
let's be honest.
They should. So many good fights drifted away a couple of years ago in that division, and they shouldn't drift away now.
Well, Chris Senegal's coming over to us. He was a value for money fighter. And he does a great job keeping the flag flying for Bristol in the West Country. He's absolutely delighted by what Stone did there. Poleaxed him with the right hand.
He really did. Got everything into that punch. Bent the knees, overhand right, full power. There you see it, right on the chin. And he wasn't going to beat the count after that.
He may not be able to beat Vernon Forrest, and he might not be able to beat Shane Mosley, but he beat a heck of a lot of other people. This is a good fighter.
It's a top-level fighter, just short of the real big, big names and big world class, but he'll give a lot of fighters plenty trouble.
Big win for Adrian Stone tonight. Not so much the fact that he beat Farai Musllwa, who was stopped by James Hare and by the London-based Ghanaian Joshua Akini, but it was the way he did it. Looked good. Still around.
Ladies and gentlemen, timekeeper John Lee has recorded a time of 2 minutes and 5 seconds of the fourth round on a count out. Your winner from Bristol, Adrian Stone. And show your appreciation for Farai Musllwa.
Another exciting talent, Ted Bami, tops the bill here in Plymouth tonight at light welterweight. That is next Bami against Samuel Malinga. And he too comes from another African stable, promising big things against Bami tonight. So Bami knows it could be his toughest test. Stone has come through more of a test than we expected here tonight, it must be said. But at the same time, he's done it in style against Musllwa. Great excitement. Let's hear from him again. He is back. He's with Craig Slater.
Well, congratulations, Adrian. That was an excellent performance tonight.
Yeah, thank you very much. I really wasn't expecting such a tough fight. You know, as I really haven't been too busy. You know, the fight really, it woke me up. Maybe it was something that I possibly needed, but I certainly wasn't expecting something like this.
He was a tall, awkward opponent, and he came with plenty of ambition early on.
Yeah, I think he really, you know, he probably looked at, you know, what I've done in my career, and I think he really capitalized, went back to the gym, and really worked on how to defeat me. And I will say one thing, man, he was very tough.
Clearly your power hasn't gone, and it was an excellent finish from you at the end.
Thank you very much. I was happy with the outcome, you know.
Just talk us through it here.
Well, I'll be honest with you. I really don't remember too much of the fight. You know, to be honest, I can't even remember the shot that I caught him with.
It was a heavy right hand.
Yeah, if you say it was a heavy right hand, fair enough. Right now, I'm a little bit, you know, all excited with the outcome, and, you know, I can't really talk too well right now. Well,
let's bring in your manager, Chris Senegar. You understand Sergio Martinez in the autumn for the IBO title. Is that signed and sealed now?
Yeah, that's signed and sealed September the 20th at Wichert Sports Centre, Bristol. We're just raring to go.
And Adrian, of course, we saw him defeat Richard Williams recently. That could be a tough one for you.
Oh, definitely, definitely. Well, you know, I look at every fight a very tough fight. You know, I train very exceptionally hard for every single fight, regardless of the opponent, of his record. I'm in the gym, and I've been doing it ever since I went to the United States. I train very, very tough for every single fight.
Well, you said you came back to this country to retire, but we clearly haven't heard the last of you just yet.
Well, yeah, I really have. I've come back really just to, you know, give it my last shot. There's no place like home, so this is why I'm back here.
Well done tonight.
Thank you very much.
He wasn't expecting it to be tough. We weren't either, it must be said. But Nicky, in the long run, it's probably the best thing that could have happened, isn't it?
Yeah, terrific performance. I think Musllwa must have been weight weak in the 10-7 welterweight, because he looked so strong tonight. He started very sharply. And what I was so impressed was Adrian Stone took some tremendously big punches in that first round, and he came back very, very well. And he's always got well-planted feet, always good base, never loses balance. Tremendously accurate puncher, and we see that here. But he was shocked at the beginning, but in the end he came through. Musllwa luckily was mixing it with him.
It has been a while. Stone is 32 years of age. Any signs of rust or aging?
No, I don't think so. I think luckily his style doesn't show that sort of those signs easily. He's compact. He comes to a fight, rumbles in. Very accurate and very, very powerful, and would be a big, big test, as has already been said, for any of the big boys, and certainly Sergio Martinez.
Is it possible, in your opinion, that the best nights for Stone could be in front of him, even now?
It's possible. You know, he's that sort of fighter. People never lose their punches. The last thing you lose, you'll always have that. He's very accurate. He's probably very, very fit. We didn't see it longer than four there, but I think it's a good chance.
Interesting how they'll see the future now, Nicky. You know, we have the likes of Takaloo in this country. That might be a fans' fight for British supporters. Also, Jamie Moore, British and Commonwealth champion. Do you see them interested in those?
Oh, Takaloo will be a tremendous fight. Politics may keep them apart. Jamie Hare and Moore, like you. Jimmy Hare's a little bit of weight below, but some exciting fights that could be made down the line.
As Chris Senegar told us there, though, internationally, Sergio Martinez would appear to be the next man in line, even if it is the IBO belt, a secondary title that Stone would bid for then. Worldwide, the number one undoubtedly, Oscar De La Hoya, getting ready now to defend against Shane Mosley in September, of course. And don't forget, another of his biggest rivals returns on Sunday. The Fernando Vargas comeback against Fitz van der Poel, and also Manny Pacquiao against Emmanuel Lucero, the unbeaten Mexican, for the IBF World Super Bantamweight title. It's another fantastic lineup, world-class boxing, all summer on Sky Sports. Sky Sports 3, 1:30, Sunday afternoon. It's Ted Bami who tops the bill here tonight on Saturday Fight Night, but can he make short work of this job? Craig Slater went to find out.
He has the hand speed and razor-sharp reflexes. Now boxing barber Ted Bami aims to prove he's a cut above. Knockout.
I knew that I had a gift for my hand. I can do anything with my hand, you know? Like I can box, like I can cut hair. I started doing it from when I was at school, from when I was little. You know, like, you know, one of these, cut my hair, now cut your hair. That's how we started, that's how I started it, and then I just take it from there.
A classy shot from Ted Bami.
In the ring, Bami's no stylist, but his direct approach gets results.
I don't respect anybody inside the ring. I can fight, I can box, I can move, I can do all kind of things.
And he's hot on the trail of 10-stone trio, Eamon McGee, Junior Witter, and Ricky Hatton.
They're good fighters. I like Hatton. I like his style. He's a good fighter. But I believe I'm already out there.
It will take a special fighter to beat Ted Bami. It's not, you know, as a trainer, it's not every day you say you've got a complete package, you know. I believe I've got the complete package right here.
Brixton-based, Ted's Bami Army fans won't let him forget his Congan roots.
For us, Ted is like an ambassador for the country outside. What is going now in Congo, you know, Congo has been involved in the war for the last 4 years. We lost more than 4 million people. Through Ted, this is a champion. We like him to be a champion for the country.
I would love to go back to Congo and fight. You know, it's quite, this is my mother's land, you know, this is where I was born. I would love to go down there and fight.
But Samuel Malinga is an equally tough African who's triumphed in Britain before.
And he really felt that.
He'd be calling line, so he must have something on him. You know, that calling line still can't match my power, so by hitting Malinga, make him think he's going to think twice.
It's a cutthroat business at this level, and against this difficult customer, Bami has to get it right.
He's good. I'm good. So the best person winning in the night.
I guess we call that quiet confidence behind him. What did you make of his last display against Laszlo Herzig?
He started very slowly, you know, and against Malinga he'll need to start a bit faster. But the one quality that he showed in this is that he was fit and he was strong and he kept on. The first four or five rounds he lost comfortably, really. He was behind on points, but he worked his way back into the fight and was very, very strong. And we'll see here now how he takes over. His fitness is very, very good. He'll need that because Malinga works very hard and is a good puncher himself.
Clearly, he does come prepared, Nicky. It's something of a mystery, then, that this work rate can just be a little bit low for the top level.
Yeah, that's a problem. And
it's in his nature to fight in that way, isn't it?
With a lot of fighters, it's that. You know, they're naturally lazy fighters. But let's see tonight whether he picks it up and boxes at a better rate. But the one thing I think we're confident with Ted Bami is he can do the distance and he can be strong at the end. And that's what he'll need to be against Malinga. He'll need to be durable and strong.
And he has seen off some good men so far. Another British prospect, Colin Lyons, had won 21 in a row until he ran into Samuel Malinga on Malinga's first appearance in Britain, and yeah, it was well remembered, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, well, he was brought over to give a good performance but lose, and Lyons was a good prospect who was boxing well, but Malinga was just, you know, non-stop here. He was always on top of Lyons. Lyons is not the biggest of punchers, but was expected to win, and he just walked through everything Lyons had to offer, and Lyons did fight well, but was worn down.
So will it be the same Malinga tactically tonight, try to press Bami?
Yeah, I think that's his style. He's a good work rate coming forward, trades on durability and a fair punch, and that's what he'll be trying to do, weigh down Bami. It's a big ask, though.
Nicky, if he's come and beaten Colin Lyons, he comes here tonight to beat Bami as well,
yes,
doesn't he?
He's
not casting the role of opponent anymore.
He comes to win, and this is this may not be two massive names boxing each other tonight, but it's a really hot fighting prospect.
And a very distinguished man in the Malinga corner tonight, the former WBA and IBF World Super Featherweight Champion, Brian Mitchell, is the man behind Malinga. Let's hear from him now with Craig Slater.
Yes, certainly an atmosphere of quiet confidence in the Malinga dressing room. Brian, what's Samuel's mood ahead of this one?
Well, we've come here to win. There's no doubt about that. He wants to be the world champion. He's currently the IBF Intercontinental Champion. He's undefeated with me in the last 3 years. And we're here to win, that's for sure. We want the title.
Tactically, how are you going to approach this one?
We're going in there with work rate. We're going to outbox him, outfight him, and do what we've got to do to win the world title.
I mean, that could be the key. There have been question marks over Ted Bami's work rate. Can we expect Samuel to set a fast pace?
Well, it's going to be a hell of a fast pace from both fighters, I expect. But we've tried, I mean, Sammy's ready for 24 rounds if need be. And yeah, we had to put up a great show and take the title back home.
And we know, of course, that Samuel's come and won over in Britain before, so he won't be fazed by the atmosphere at all.
No, he's not fazed by the atmosphere. He's been up against the odds many times in his career. And he knows what it takes to win a title, and he wants to win the title tonight.
Thanks very much.
Appreciate it. Malinga, the South African Prospect of the Year in 2002. That is not an accolade that's handed out too easily. So we're all set here in Plymouth. Ted Bami has so many rivals. Plenty in Britain alone, it must be said. But he knows that a victory over Malinga will certainly put him right on the tails of men like Hatton, Witter and McGee. But it looks like being his toughest test so far. It's next. Sunday, we're live from Blackpool for the World Match Play Darts Championships. Our coverage begins at 7 o'clock Sunday evening on Sky Sports 1. Here at the Plymouth Pavilions tonight, Saturday fight night, and time for our top of the bill. Ted Bami, Samuel Malinga at light welterweight. And just a reminder for Sky Digital viewers that you can access the Sky Active menu at any time simply by pressing the red button on your remote control. All is set then. Our master of ceremonies for the formalities here, John McDonald.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's the fight of the night, the main event. Please welcome to the ring now from Johannesburg, South Africa, Samuel Malinga.
Well, as you've already heard tonight, there is a great deal of confidence in the South African camp that they are going to beat Ted Bami here tonight in the top of the bill. Malinga, only 23 years of age, and he's on quite a run. The prospect of the year in South Africa last year after a shock fourth round demolition of the well-regarded Stefanus Carr. Then he came to Britain and put an end to the unbeaten start of the career of Colin Lyons, who looked to be going places. Very busy. Will he be too busy for Bami? A lot of people think he might, you know. It's a risky fight, this, for Bami's people, isn't it?
It's a very risky fight because Malinga works very hard. He's good, he's fast, he can punch a little bit, and he's improving all the time. So this is a pretty tough fight for Ted Bami.
Malinga, who arrived in this country a week ago and has been preparing assiduously. For the first time tonight, Ted Bami tops a bill. All he's got to do now is win. Making the long, lonely walk to the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the champion from Brixton, Dangerous Ted Bami!
Well, this is the man who's on the heels in Britain, in the 10-stone talent, behind Ricky Hatton and Eamon McGee and Junior Witter. But can he cut it at this higher level after one or two eye-catching wins over the likes of Francis Barrett, Michael Smythe, Bradley Price? Well, can he, Glenn?
Well, he's a good fighter and he's growing in confidence all the time. He really does believe in himself. And his career, he pretty much come out of nowhere. And they call him Dangerous because he does upset the odds, and I think he really believes in himself.
13 wins, one defeat so far for Bami. You've heard of the barber of Seville. Here's the barber of Brixton by trade, but he might be giving up the day job if he moves into the higher echelons of boxing earners. Tonight's a big, big night for him, make no mistake. Originally from Zaire or the Congo, whatever you want to call it. Here's the tail of the tape for the fight tonight. Bami, a couple of years older at 25. Malinga is taller, has the minute reach advantage, nothing much. And both of them comfortably inside the 10-stone weight limit for tonight's fight. Bami a pro for 5 years, Malinga for four. Not much in it in terms of experience there. Bami with a slightly higher stoppage percentage.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event, the fight of the night. Barry Hearn for Ringside Boxing Promotions. In association with Chris Sanagar and the Bristol Boys. All in association with Prince Promotions and Matchroom Sport. All sponsored here by PokerMillion.com for a great game of online poker. And the Plymouth Evening Herald. A very warm welcome to our sports fans joining us here live and exclusive on Sky Sports. You've joined us for the very best ringside seat in the business. All the officials have been appointed by the WBF and the British Boxing Board of Control here present at ringside. Supervisor Alex Papafiou. Timekeeper Bell is Neil Berda. Three scoring judges, Richie Davis, Mark Green and Ian John Lewis. Along with referee John Coyle, all the officials are from England. They are the officials, here are the contestants, and firstly, the challenger. He's fighting out of the red corner wearing the red trunks, weighing in at 9 stone, 12 pounds, 3 ounces. 16 fight record, 13 wins, 7 inside the scheduled distance, 2 losses and 1 draw. Coming to the ring as the reigning IBO Intercontinental Champion from beautiful Johannesburg, South Africa. Please welcome Samuel Malinga. And across the ring, fighting out of the blue corner, comes the champion. He's wearing the white trunks, trimmed with blue, weighed in at 9 stone, 13 pounds, 6 ounces. 14 fight record, 13 wins, 7 inside the scheduled distance, just 1 defeat. Coming to the ring, as the reigning and defending WBF light welterweight champion from Brixton, South London, it's Dangerous Ted Bami. So, sports fans and Sky Sports fans, let's get the action underway then. 12 rounds of boxing for the WBF light welterweight championship.
And every expectation of a good fight here as well. John Coyle,
okay,
referee.
You know the rules. Just remind you, I want 3 things. Obey my instructions, obey the rules, and let's see good sportsmanship. Shake hands, good luck to you both.
Bami, who had to flee his native country, Zaire, amid the revolution when he was only 12 years old. His parents sent him to this country. He thinks his parents are now dead. He doesn't know. He was brought up in London by his uncle. So Ted Bami now fighting out of Brixton in the white trunks, and this dangerous South African Samuel Malinga, 23, who has already come to this country and beaten the well-regarded Colin Lines, forcing him to retire. Bami's often been a slow starter as well, Glenn.
Yes, he has. Sometimes it's just pretty casual when he starts. You want to see him pick it up and really put the pressure on Malinga early. Let him know what he's all about.
But he's a confident individual and he hits pretty hard. There's a lot of sparring with super middles and light heavyweights, that kind of thing, Bami. Says the light welterweights aren't tough enough to spar with him. Bami, who actually sparred in his amateur days in England squads a couple of times with Ricky Hatton, for whom he has the highest regard, he says. Maybe one of these days he'll find himself in the same professional ring as Hatton, but he has to be winning fights like tonight's if he's going to go that far.
Bami carrying that left hand very low. Plenty room for Malinga to get a right on.
Malinga looking as if he's just having a look at Bami early on, not doing very much so far. Bami is trained by the former European champion James Cook, a well-regarded trainer, who says that Bami hits so hard he can't take him on the pads. Whether all this is hype ahead of the fight or the kind of material to build up Bami in the public's mind. We'll see. He has to prove it all in the ring with results. He's been getting some good ones, but this is another test again. Sharp little right hand from him, which seems to land around the ear of Malinga there.
Bami just looked pretty physically strong, well conditioned.
This is a big opportunity for him tonight to set himself up as a headline act. White trunks, remember, Bami. Malinga looks circumspect early on.
He does, very much so. I don't know whether he's felt the power of Bami, but he doesn't really want to get involved here.
Maybe this is a prolonged reconnaissance mission from Samuel Malinga, who comes from Johannesburg, South Africa. First time I've heard it described as beautiful in a while by the MC tonight. Pretty dangerous place, if you ask me. Centre of the picture, Brian Lawrence on the far side, experienced trainer. It's a good team they've got there with Marvin Stone. He's got the backup, Bami. Cookie says it'll take a good man to beat him now. His only defeat was against Jacek Bielski, the Pole, stopped in four, but that was back in September 2000. 10 unbeaten since. Bami in the white trunks won the first round. I think he just hurt Malinga with one little right hand that landed around by the ear. Malinga seemed to want to hold on after that. Curiously in his shell in that first round, the South African, I thought, Glenn.
Yeah, very much so. He just didn't get any shots on. He just seemed a little worried of Bami. Maybe that he's heard about the punching power, but he did. I don't know if that right hand hurt him, but he certainly just kept out the way.
I think Bami is going to need to get busier as a fighter if he's going to move up in level. The longer distance fights might suit him, however. He's only stopped 7 of 13 wins so far, but that's because he's been involved in 4 6 rounders, that kind of thing, in the main.
Yeah, but interesting, of his last 7 fights in, he's stopped 5 of them, so I think that power is growing, and with strength and with experience.
In the open air at Cardiff Castle, he dramatically stopped the previously unbeaten Bradley Price with 2 seconds to go. Got to him late that night. Malinga doing absolutely nothing so far. Surprisingly, we thought he'd be busy. Body shots from Bami as they work in close. Bami, who holds his left glove, you'll notice, very, very low, dangling down by his side, which in theory might make him open to right hands if Malinga can find any. What do you think of that, Glenn?
Well, it is very low. Some fighters do hold it like that. Lennox Lewis being one of them, but sometimes you can just turn your shoulder in and that can avoid the punches, but it's not the best idea of defence.
Neither fighter what you'd call busy so far. Malinga starts to get going but misses a lot.
He's got one right hand in there, just showing that Bami needs to get that left glove up.
Malinga just starting to get going, but his timing's not there at the moment.
Bami hasn't done a great deal in this round either, and Malinga's just starting to pick it up towards the end.
Some good body shots in there from Bami. Who might be forced to work harder than he's used to here by this South African.
Come on.
He doesn't need to move. Make him go backwards. Don't show him the spin. You know, with the judges, we might have lost it down two, right? It means we're two rounds down.
Listen.
You got your distance now?
Left of the picture there is Brian Mitchell, great world champion in super featherweight, the road warrior they used to call him, and Harold Volbrecht on the far side, who was one of the world's top welterweights for a while. He was due to have fought Lloyd Hannigan, but it never happened because Hannigan didn't want to fight a South African.
And there he's finally getting through the right hand, Malinga. Also heard Dean Powell in the corner.
There's a bit of a Lloyd Hannigan link-up as well tonight, because Hannigan used to manage Bami in the early part of his career. Malinga starts to get his jab going, and if he does, that might mean problems for Bami, who is outreached here. Looks like that anyway. Looks as if he's outreached by a bit more than the tail of the tape said. Significantly taller he looks, doesn't he?
And now Malinga looking to try and get shots off and using those fast hands.
A little left as they worked in close from Bami. He was doing a bit of holding as well. Just a shade untidy early on.
Yeah, the styles aren't quite gelling. They're both trying very hard and missing with quite a lot of shots.
Not the left hand of Bami there. Looked a bit of a slap to me, but it had effect all right. Then a right uppercut from Bami too. Just that bit more accurate and clean with his work, I think, Bami so far. He's trying quite a lot of leather now, Malinga, but he's missing a heck of a lot, you know, Glenn.
Yes, he is. He's trying very hard, not that much getting through. But Bami needs to keep his work rate up because he's not throwing that.
Oh! What about that? He did miss with that one. Down goes Bami, and he might not get up from it, too. All over the place. Third round. It stopped, and Bami's dream night turns into a nightmare. Samuel Malinga, the South African, does it again. Falls into the arms of Dean Powell. They said he'd win. They said he'd ruin it for Bami, and he has.
Well, what about that? Didn't he find the punch? Missing with everything, but he didn't miss with the one that counted, and that was big enough to ruin the night of Ted Bami.
Just knocked everything out of him with that perfectly timed shot. Bami hardly knows what hit him, but there was no doubt about it. John Coyle couldn't let it go on. He was gone, wasn't he?
And that's your answer for a law, carrying your left glove, too low. He paid the penalty there.
Well, we did point out that, didn't we, early in the fight?
It was very, very low. I don't know if he was just felt that confident or, you know, was just cocky, but he paid a big penalty for doing that with an excellent right hand from Samuel Malinga.
Terrible night for him, but this guy Malinga, who looked ragged in a lot of his work until that point. Now take a check on this. Bang, right hand, good night.
And you just had to look where the left hand was. It was down below his shoulder, very low. We see it there, he throws the jab, drops his left hand, wide open for the right.
That's a technical fault, isn't it? Throw a jab and bring it back down by your waist, leave yourself open to a right hand.
Exactly.
Malinga,
right.
Malinga said thanks, didn't he?
Yeah, you bring the jab back to your shoulder, and he really did get everything into that punch. Just saw a little gap, and then all of a sudden built it up and really let it go.
Oh, he bounced off the canvas horribly, Bami then. He was on his feet, he tried to protest, but I don't think there's any doubt about it. John Curl got that right. Bami was poleaxed by that. Look at the way he's stumbling towards the corner as if to confirm that the referee was spot on. Now look at Malinga, just look at that. Into the arms of Brian Mitchell, who knows what it's like to win away, because he always had to fight away all the way through his career. The old road warrior himself, they're celebrating, Harold Volbrecht as well. It's a big night for them. He's come here and he's done it again, and the gamble with Bami's backfired horribly.
That's right, and Brian Mitchell, the road warrior, quite happy to bring his fighters over here if that's the end result, but he deserved it. What a great shot from Samuel Malinga.
Back to the drawing board for the Barber of Brixton, I'm afraid.
Ladies and gentlemen, timekeeper Neil Berda has recorded a time of 1 minute 45 seconds of the third round. In the act of rising, a count out. Therefore, your winner and the new WBF Light Waterweight Champion from Johannesburg, South Africa, Samuel Malinga.
He wins it, and listen to this. Bami's protesting. He told John Curl, the referee, that he thought it was a headbutt.
That shows you how good a punch it was, doesn't it? He didn't even know what he was hit with.
Ted, check the video.
And now, to present the championship belt, we call upon our supervisor, Alex Papafio.
I tell you, Ian, he does now know that it was a right hook, because he's been leaning over the rope, looking down to our TV monitor. And I don't think there is any dispute now that Bami accepts it's been a savage, hard lesson learned. What a knockout. Samuel Malinga, only his eighth stoppage win. Can't have had better than that, can he? Had to work hard against Colin Lyons, went into the second half of the fight. Stunning performance here tonight. Now Ted Bami is come to ringside, and Craig Slater is going to try and piece together what happened with him.
Well Ted, it was supposed to be your big night tonight. You must be terribly disappointed with the way it's worked out.
Yeah, I am. You know, I don't know, I just don't remember what shot he caught me with, but I thought it was a headbutt, and he walked right, you know, I feel with his head on it in my head, you know.
You were complaining at the end that you thought you could have carried on. Did you think you could?
Of course, I was all right, you know what I'm saying? I was all right with Korean, you know what I'm saying? I just stood and they took my count and I was all right. You know, I don't know what the referee stopped me for.
Well, let's have a look at the punch that actually did the damage. It was a right hand.
There you go. There it is.
Do you think you were guilty, perhaps, of carrying your left hand a little low? Was that where the problem arose?
Yeah. I see the shot, yeah. I ain't going to comment, actually. I thought it was a headbutt, so it was definitely a punch, so, you know. I just don't believe I lost the fight, you know what I'm saying? I don't believe he can beat me.
Well, let's bring in your trainer, James Cook. This is the stoppage here that you were complaining about, but I think it was the right decision.
Yeah, we wasn't complaining, really. Ted was complaining, but obviously he'd just been knocked out, you know, feel a punch, so he thought it was a headbutt, but it was a good shot, you know. He come up, had no guard on his way up, and he got caught with a good shot.
So you're right to say he couldn't really have gone on from there?
No, you know, he couldn't have gone on, you know what I mean?
Well, Ted, can you come back from this? Will we see you back in action soon?
Lennox Lewis, when he got knocked out by Lennox Lewis, he said, can he come back?
Well, obviously, Ted, very disappointed about this. James, can he come back from this?
Yeah, come on. You should know that a good fighter always come back. I mean, every fighter, every good champion lose a fight, and to prove themselves, they've got to come back. And Ted got to prove himself by coming back.
Well, we hope he can. Commiserations tonight.
It'll take some time for them to piece it all together. More on this. Savage defeat for Bami, wonderful win for Malinga when we come back. And more live action from here in Plymouth. Scott Dann, the hometown middleweight, against Kreshnick Qato. That one live after the break. Live football for you on Sunday. The Asia Cup final will be between Newcastle United and Chelsea, Sunday, 1:30, Sky Sports 1. Our big winner here tonight in Plymouth is Samuel Malinga. He has seized Ted Bami's light welterweight title belt and knocked a huge dent in Bami's reputation at the same time with a stunning third round knockout. Well done to Malinga and his camp. Craig Slater is waiting to speak to them.
Well, Samuel, many congratulations. A terrific win for you tonight.
Yes, of course, yes, we're looking for a win for the world title, which was a good way to go forward for me.
We were expecting you perhaps to outwork Ted Bami, but it was a spectacular right hand you found to finish it.
Actually, my trainer told me that to work from the first round. As I've said it yesterday, that he can be knocked any round, any time, any minute. So I was expecting a knockout any time, any round, any minute.
And Brian, we saw that Ted was carrying that left hand a little low. Did you pick that punch out?
We watched him on the videos that he drops the left hand, but I mean, you know, he's all credit to him. He's a very strong guy, and we knew it was going to be tough all along. But I mean, the right hand was just out of the textbook, an awesome right hand. And we want to thank the promoters and the WBA for giving us the opportunity. Samuel loves fighting out here. The people treat him well, and we'll be back.
He certainly proved himself international class. Where can he go from here?
Well, we will defend the WBF title and see what the promoters offer us next, you know.
Of course, there's some big name like welterweights in this country. Ricky Hatton amongst them. Would you like to fight him?
He doesn't even know Ricky Hatton, but I know Ricky is a hell of a fighter. And, we're looking to move up and fight the best in the world.
Well done tonight.
Seems like a knockout was in the back of Mitchell's mind. But it wasn't in the front of his mind, was it?
No, exactly. And, you know, Bami's a good fighter, and you can't expect him to knock the likes of Ted Bami over in three rounds that easily. But tremendous fight and tremendous punch.
It wasn't tactically the fight you thought it might be tonight, Nicky, was it?
No, but...
Why was that?
Well, Bami started quickly for a start. You know, he's been known to start very slowly, and he did start very quickly. He took the initiative, and I think, you know, Malinga was a little hesitant. And but when he stepped in, I mean, this punch, we don't really need to describe that. Everybody can see that's a perfect classic right hand. And Ted Bami, you know, was well and surely gone.
He was, as they say, made for it, wasn't he?
Yeah, well, he's a classic puncher, isn't he? He comes forward trying to land his own big shots, but unfortunately puts his own power onto his opponent's punches. And he walked onto this one. Glenn picked up on the left hand being low. He had it low. He walked on, putting his weight onto the punch. Doubled it up. And, you know, at this stage, I mean, John Cole had no chance of letting it go on. It was definitely too wobbly to go on. It was a good stoppage, no doubt about it. You can see he's still falling there. There's no doubt about that. He was complaining mostly there because he thought he was, as we've already heard, hit with the head. His head, but he wasn't.
I think as they take stock, they will take it with good grace, Nicky. He's just found out, Bami, what a really tough division light welterweight is, hasn't he?
Yeah, well, exactly. If we thought the three at the very top were tough, you know, that man, Malinga, is up with them. And there's so many guys in the world level, British level, and certainly African level, that's going to give everybody such a good competitive fight.
Bami can come back, certainly, but what about Malinga?
Well, Malinga goes from strength to strength, and I think Brian Mitchell was correct. They're going to be looking now to match up with the three big names in this country, because he's very durable, you know, and we've seen it for our own eyes the last two fights. He takes a good shot, he's got a great work rate, and can punch himself.
Thanks, Nicky. Rapturous reception behind me here, live. Scott Dann has entered the ring, the middleweight, in front of his hometown crowd here tonight. Southpaw returning after his defeat against Howard Eastman, against Kreshnick Qato, the Albanian based in North London. So, let's rejoin John McDonald for the full introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, we continue the action, 8 rounds in the middleweight division. Introducing to you firstly, he's fighting out of the red corner wearing the red trunks trimmed with black, weighing in at 11 stone, 10 pounds, 4 ounces, bringing a 7-fight record, 4 wins, 1 inside the scheduled distance, and 3 losses. Originally from Albania, now boxing out of Wembley. Please welcome Kreshnick Qato! The former IBO Intercontinental Champion Mr. John Lee of Plymouth, and referee in charge of the action from Swindon is Grant Wett. This is 8 3-minute rounds.
Command at all times. In the event of a knockdown, boxer standing, go to a neutral corner. Defend yourself at all times. Shake hands, good luck.
Well, Scott, Dann, is very, very big news in Plymouth. He sold 600 tickets tonight. He took hundreds up to Nottingham with him, where he was beaten in three rounds by the world-class Howard Eastman in a fight for the British, Commonwealth and European middleweight titles. No shame in that. In fact, he had Eastman legitimately down, though the referee didn't count it. I think Eastman's camp even admitted it afterwards. He's in the purple trunks here, the Plymouth hero, Scott Dann. And they haven't had a British champion in this city since Joe Simons back in 1914-16, nearly 100 years. Might Dann do it for them one day? Just listen to the atmosphere. He's the guy that sold the tickets on this bill tonight. And he's in here with this fellow, Kreshnick, Qato, an Albanian who's based in North London and whose camp think that he can give Dann real problems here tonight.
Well, it's obvious who everybody's come to see. Very, very popular, Scott Dann. Right now, the southpaw stance, but he might have a tough fight here.
Well, I'll tell you how big he is here, Glenn. They had a computer centre that they were going to open in this city, and they tried to get Prince Charles to do it. And when he said he couldn't, their next choice was Scott Dann.
It's pretty big, isn't it?
Next to royalty, he is around here. A couple of right hands. He's quite happy counter-punching, usually, is Dann. Saw him in this Plymouth Pavilions before, beating Alvis Adonisi of South Africa in seven rounds. That was a couple of years back. Best win, a first round stoppage of Delroy Leslie of Carshalton. That was an eye-catching one for Dann. But I think the British Championship is the kind of thing he should be aiming at now at this stage. 29. 1-4, lost 3 so far. Qato in the red trunks. But according to his camp, they dispute all three of those defeats. With a sharp little right hand there, and a straight right has put Dann down. Dann goes down on this night of shots here. Nasty moment. He's not badly hurt. It was not much more than a jab, but the crowd here worried now about what might happen to Scott Dann. He said he had a little bit of problems just getting himself fully motivated for this one after fighting Eastman last time. This is a bit of a rehab fight for him, but will it prove to be that?
Well, he needs to suddenly get the motivation now, because now there might be a tough fight in front of him, and he needs to get his own punches going.
Qato, who's managed by Dean Powell. Good straight right there by Dann. It seems none the worse for the knockdown. He wasn't shaken up or anything like that, but he definitely was on the floor. One of the three men to have beaten Qato, by the way, was former WBO champion Paul Silky Jones. Well, some dramatics in round one. To give him a pep talk, Chris Senegar in the corner.
Well, maybe he's just caught cold. I'm sure they'll be hoping, all the fans here, that he was. They're just missing with the shots himself, clipped with the right hand, and then just nothing more than a left jab, and then put a good right hand right through the middle. And that is the shot for the southpaw. Just clipped with a jab there, a little jab just to steady him up, and then found a nice right hand right down the middle.
Certainly not in the script. This is an undercard fight tonight, but it's been getting the big treatment by the boys at the Plymouth Evening Herald. Writer Andy Phelan, who gives Scott Dann great coverage around here. And he'll be getting big coverage as well on Monday, but what will the story be saying? Don't forget purple trunks, Dann. And a those little left hands. He does like to counter-punch. I think he's more natural doing that. Qato, angular, upright. Looks quite easy to hit, but he looks strong, doesn't he?
He does look strong. Maybe that knockdown was the wake up that Dann needs, but he needs to start getting busy, letting shots go.
Qato in the red trunks, trained by Phil Pearson, and Luigi Leo at the Trojan Gym in North London.
A solid jab there from Dann.
Fighters who could just perhaps do with a little bit more movement from the waist and a bit more head movement, this upright European style. It's the left hand getting in from Dann that time.
I think that's one of Dann's problems. He's a little bit tight around the shoulders, just stays up straight up, and I think that's where he's can be easy to hit.
Qato, by the way, has won his last three. His confidence is high at the moment. And he's run in there. He's got him and he turns his back. And that means an end. A sudden end. Dann gets the job done to rapturous applause in round two. And the end came right out of nowhere. And the moment that Qato turned his back, the referee had to stop it.
Yeah, he did. He was told a good shot. The legs were all over the place there. Just fell into the ropes, Qato, and turned his back.
Dann in round one, a winner in round two. Relief is one of the emotions swirling around this arena, where they are all mad keen Scott Dann fans. Had to win that one though, didn't he, really?
Well, he did, yet again, fell back in contention again. Looks a little upset, Qato, but it was a good shot. It just falls out of range. Qato Dann looks for, there's a short right hand.
Left hook it was, wasn't it then? Looked like it. Close in. I think that was the one that did it, and he just turns his back. Well, they're complaining, the Qato count, and saying you should have given him a count. What nonsense is that?
That's right, look, he's just turned, leant over the ropes. Nothing really else they can do.
I can only think there are a few Qato fans who've travelled down to see him who've got involved in some argument with the locals.
Yeah, I think it's all right, and they're settling everybody down. Just a bit of excitement there.
Somebody will call it a riot in the papers on Monday, I dare say. It certainly isn't, just a scuffle. Dann's won, but I think there's got to be a question about whether he can come through to be a British champion. What do you think, Liam?
Well, I think he needs a little bit of improvement. He's got to move his head. He's a bit easy hit, and he's got to get rid of that.
Ladies and gentlemen, timekeeper John Lee has recorded a time of 1 minute 45 seconds of the second round. Referee Grant Wallace has stopped the contest. Qato in no position to continue. Your winner, Plymouth's number one son, the Dynamite, Scott Dann! And show your appreciation for Kreshnick, Qato.
Four knockdowns in three fights so far on Saturday Fight Night, and still more action to come here. Michael Hunter, the unbeaten super bantamweight hope, travelling down from the northeast against Rocky Dean. That one's still to come. Scott Dann wisely just trying to calm the excitability of some of his followers here tonight. Well, his big news, as Ian said, they'll probably write it up as a riot. It wasn't. But everybody got very excited. They love him here. It's a good win for him. He's back after that defeat by Eastman. Craig Slater will talk to him now.
Yeah, Scott, you're back to winning ways. It was a short fight, but it was certainly exciting, wasn't it?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, in the first round, I just walked right onto a right hand. Never hurt me, just knocked me right off balance, right onto my backside. I mean, but when I caught him, he was in no condition to continue. I mean, the referee was right, he may be questioning it, but if I hit him again, he could have been seriously hurt. You've seen his legs, he was wobbling all over the shot. I mean, I was ready to line him up, and I've seen the referee running in, so I should have hit him again, really, but I mean, that's life. I mean, but it was definitely right to stop the fight.
Of course, you were coming off that defeat by Howard Eastman. Were there any doubts in your mind when you went down in that first round?
No, not at all. I mean, Chris and Nigel gave me a good talk beforehand, said, look, whatever happens, if you get hurt, you get knocked down, anything at all, just let it go above your head. Because last time when I put Eastman down, it played on my mind, and I never really concentrated. Then I just put it to the back of my mind, got on with the next round. I knew I would catch up with him soon. I knew it was good 8-3s to go. I mean, 7-3s to go. So I caught him in the power tool, you know.
It was a terrific left hand to finish it.
Oh, definitely. And I could have hit him again. You know, I was lining him up and I seen the ref run in. I should have maybe hit him again, but I was a bit slow to react. But he was in no position to continue. He was totally gone.
Let's bring in your manager, Chris Sanagar. Of course, Howard Eastman perhaps looking for a world title now. So perhaps there's a chance for Scott to figure at British level again.
Definitely, I think, outside Howard Eastman, Scott Dann's the best middleweight domestically. And we just want an opportunity to bring it down here again in Plymouth.
I think you and your fans can enjoy a nice celebration tonight. Well done.
Thank you very much.
He will breathe a huge sigh of relief once the adrenaline subsides, Nicky, mainly because he was nervous. He was anxious early on tonight, yeah, following defeat by Eastman.
And he was caught in that first round. You know, he was hurt. There's no doubt about that. I saw Qato fight on a non-televised show in Leeds a few months ago, and he looked really, really good. And when I saw the matchup tonight, I thought, this is a tough comeback for Scott Dann. You know, really tough.
Do you think Scott Dann knew that?
I don't know. I don't think he probably would have done, because, as I say, it was non-televised and this event wasn't seen by many people. He would have read about it, but Qato looks better than he actually was. Looks better than actually his record.
Indeed, and nonetheless, Qato coming into this 3 wins in a row, the best spell of his short professional career so far, and he did settle faster, didn't he?
Yeah, he did, and he's a sharp puncher, and that was a terrific shot he caught Scott Dann with, and there was no doubt he was hurt, and he could have hit him again. Scott Dann had his hand on the floor. Watch this now. He's open to another shot. The referee hadn't jumped between them then. That could have finished it if he had done.
That may have swung it Dan's way. How do you feel Scott Dann went about getting himself back into the fight?
Yeah, he boxed very well. There's no doubt about it. He's got lots of boxing skill. And he took a few good punches in that second round before he landed a very good shot. And the referee was no doubt, he was correct to stop the fight. He didn't go down, and you can't impose a count unless the ropes stop the opponent from going down. That wasn't the case. Qato turned his back, and the referee, they can complain as much as they like, but the referee was correct.
Grant Wallace, the referee in that one. When he's lost last time out, been knocked down in the first round of his comeback fight, that is about a crisis in his career, Dann. How do you feel he dealt with that?
Yeah, I think so. And although he's won well tonight, he won't be happy with the fact he's been knocked down after suffering a third round stoppage against Eastman. But it was a good fight, nevertheless, a good win, because Qato was no mug. We knew, I knew he was a good opponent, and Scott Dann has done well tonight.
Another talent in action here tonight. He has actually travelled the length of the country to be here, though. It's the Hartlepool super bantamweight Michael Hunter, unbeaten so far, and last time out very impressive when appearing on a Sky Sports bill in Italy. Let's see if he could continue the run here in a 6-rounder against Rocky Dean.
Well, here's the emerging Michael Hunter up against Rocky Dean from Thetford in Norfolk, who starts fast in the red trunks. Dean, 25 years of age, same as Hunter, is the number two super bantamweight at the moment in Britain, behind Isham Pickering, who had that excellent win over Brian Carr the other night in Glasgow. Hunter coming off a very good win at Trieste in Italy, when he stopped Afrin Mustafa of Serbia in 5, and Mustafa had only lost 1 out of 11. He looked good that night, didn't he, Glenn?
He did look good. He started just trying a little bit too hard, but then when he suddenly just started to relax and get into it, he boxed very well indeed. That was a good stoppage win for Hunter.
Dean's won 7 out of 9 so far, only 2 by stoppage. His only defeat against Chris Jukers, and Jukers just a bit too big for him and stopped him in a round. Coming off a draw against Steve Gethin in Norwich as well, Rocky Dean. But there are a few people around his camp who fancy he might cause a shock here tonight. Hunter rangy for the weight, isn't he?
Good movement. Well done.
Comes from Hartlepool. Two times an English ABA champion at flyweight and bantam.
Under doing the same as he did in Trieste, just trying a bit harder, a little out of range, stretching with that jab. Just needs to settle down. Much better fighter when he does.
Touching down. And a count for Dean in round one.
Seven.
Mandatory eight count for Rocky Dean. A couple of right hands. Landing and an uppercut on the inside as well from Hunter, who just might be moving towards the peak of his form. He's proving to be a handful at the moment. I think he's showing improved dedication in the gym as well. One or two stories about him being a bit of a wild liver away from the gym earlier on in his career, but he looks full of it at the moment, doesn't he?
He really does. I know he's a fighter that wants to do an awful lot in this business, trying so hard.
And he'll want to get in the ring with Isham Pickering as soon as he possibly can, I'm sure. He's proving a bit of a handful for Dean in this opening round. Pretty free with the elbows as well. Left hand to the body, chopping right hand. Oh, and a right hand! Decks Rocky Dean. I don't think he's going to come back from that. In the first round, it was a big shot. Counts at eight. Gets up at about 7.5. Well, he looks all out to me. It's going to be stopped. It is stopped. All over, says referee Di Morgan. That's another big win for Michael Hunter, who looks an emerging force in this 8-stone, 10-pound super phantom weight division at the moment. No containing him tonight.
No, that was excellent. He really did. He wanted it. He was trying so hard, but the ordnance come, the shots got on, and that was a very good win for Michael Hunter.
I don't think Rocky Dean knew too much about what had hit him there. But he was in deep with Hunter, probably meeting the wrong man on the wrong night as well, I think.
Well, he had so much confidence after his win in Trieste, Hunter, and I think that was a good fight for him, and he really went into it, wanted to do a good job, and he did.
He just kept pouring on the punches like this.
Yeah, looking for the shots, trying to find the angles. Just go one around the side of the head. Not the biggest shot, but he just touched down there, Dean.
This is the first knockdown. Little right hand through the middle, I think, was the one that did it. But the second one was a big chopping right hand punch at the end of a combination.
Two really good left hooks there to the body, brought the hands down, got the left hook to the head, saw the gap as Dean come around, and then a good right hook puts him down.
And you can see there his eyes were swimming, Rocky Dean. It's a good decision, I thought, by referee Di Morgan. There was no way at all that Dean should have been allowed to carry on after that, because that knocked everything out of him. He did very well to get to his feet at all, but thank goodness he wasn't allowed to continue.
But such a good combination. Two left hooks to the body, switches it around the other side, brings it around, just waiting until he finds the opening, finally got there with the right hand.
15 wins out of 16 now for Hunter, and only his fifth by stoppage.
They have been patient with him. Is it a case of patience being rewarded now?
Yeah, I think so, and certainly his record doesn't suggest he's a big puncher, but he's punching very hard at the moment, and he's accurate. I thought he was a little bit, as Glenn said, a bit keen to get in there and try and finish his opponent off, and therefore looked a little bit loose in defence, and don't like the way he holds his mouth open too when he's punching. He could get several broken jaw along the line, but this was a good right hand, just to the back of the ear. Shock knocked on there for Dean, and I thought he was a little bit premature in celebrating his victory there, because Dean wasn't that hurt.
That's what confidence does for
you. Exactly.
You expect it.
Yeah, that's exactly right, and I think he knew that he had the beating of Rocky Dean tonight, and certainly he did, and he proved that with the second knockdown, which was tremendous, and good body work softening up Dean, and then a couple of punches to the head, right hand, left hook, and he swings Dean around, and misses the left hook here with this right hand, long shot right to the point of the jaw, and there was no coming back from that one.
16th pro fight for Hunter Nicky. He's still unbeaten. He has won a Northern Area title. Is it time to be a little bit more ambitious with him now?
Yeah, just a little bit. I don't think he's up there with the very best just yet, but he's certainly got the potential. I see there are flaws. Maybe these flaws are being seen because he's so confident and he thinks that Dean can't hurt him. Maybe with a higher class opponent, he'd be a bit tighter.
I was going to ask, have you seen him under pressure?
No, I haven't yet. So that's the question we all need to have answered. But he certainly looks good, and he's punching harder than his record suggests. He's looking very good.
Thank you, Nicky. In action here earlier tonight, a man who's got a wealth of experience. The only question was, should he even have thought about a comeback? 20 months after his last big defeat on points against Pablo Sarmiento back in November 2001, the one-time outstanding British lightweight champion, Michael Ayers, decided tonight to try again at the age of 38. The opponent, John Honey from Basingstoke, round two.
Round two.
Second round. Michael Ayers, Shaka, as he calls himself, in the black trunks, the former British lightweight champion, the blue of John Honey, the southpaw from Basingstoke, who had five cracks at the English ABA Championships, reaching the semis in his best year, 1999. So that shows he's got a bit of boxing ability to get to the last four like that. And he's showing it here. Not big punches, but there, that left hand getting through to Ayers a couple of times. And the speed here is troubling Ayers.
Yeah, also the southpaw stance. He's standing for that straight left, Ayers, and just getting hit with that too much.
So far, not so good for Michael Ayers. And this is only six rounds. That counts against him a bit, I think.
Yes, it does. He's got to really pick it up and start letting the shots go.
Let's land a right hand, but he looks at the moment as if he was he's just trying to remember what the plot lines are.
Well, the balance doesn't look good for Ayers, and that's normally the first thing that starts to go. Finds he's got a bit flat-footed and don't move that well. And unfortunately, that's how he's looking at the moment.
Can he find an answer? Again, speedy little punches from Honey, who looks like he's fancying the job, even though he was a bit late to the arena tonight. Stuck in a spot of traffic, we heard. He's getting with some good punches, and I think here he's beginning to think that maybe he can claim a famous scalp. Still time for Ayers, but he needs to pick it up, because at the moment, Honey's out boxing him.
Well, it's a bit worrying. You don't really want to see it. He's 38 now, and even if he shouldn't really be fighting, he's trying to put a bit more into his punches now.
Honey not happy about a low blow as they worked away in the corner there, as Ayers just tried to wrap him up. That's more the kind of fight that Ayers would want. Working in close, he can negate the speed. Again, very good combination punching from John Honey.
Well, Honey looking good now, starting to tee off with these nice shots.
But this is Michael Ayers, once one of the top lightweights in Britain, fighting a guy who's won five and lost nine. You do wonder why the fellas come back at the age of 38. Is it because he just couldn't think of anything else to do?
Well, it's very hard for boxers to walk away, but walk away they've got to. It's a tough sport.
You found it hard, didn't you?
Everybody finds it hard. It's what you do. It's what you've done all your life.
Yes, easy for us to pontificate and retire fighters, but he's finding it hard at the moment, Michael Ayers, and Aaron Honey's won both the rounds on my card anyway.
Round three. Round three.
Third round. What can Ayers do about this? Certainly was not part of his plot tonight to come back and suffer what would be a pretty catastrophic defeat, because the comeback will be stopped right on the launch pad if he comes a cropper here. Just flitting around him like an annoying wasp at the moment, Honey. Finding some good little angles for his punches. Can Ayers cut him off and nail him with one?
Well, that's what it's going to take, really. Ayers has got to get his respect with a good hard shot.
May just take two or three rounds for Ayers to get back anything like a semblance of timing. Just a little distress signal there from Honey. Seemed to cast a glance at the referee for some reason or another.
But he come by with a good right hoop, which just seemed to trouble Ayers.
I think one of the problems for Honey is, does he really believe he can beat somebody like Michael Ayers? Can he carry it through over the full six rounds? Just dropped the work rate a little, Honey, in this round so far.
Just slightly, but still trying to take it up now, doing a bit more.
Still no real timing, though, from Michael Ayers. Again, just no snap in his punches. The cleaner work still coming from the underdog, John Honey of Basingstoke.
Well, Honey's got that sharpness, he's got that reaction time, he can get his shots off where it just looks like Ayers thinking about it. He remembers what to do, but just can't get the punches off.
There, he misses again with the right hand. Looks frustrated. Looks like a man at the moment, doesn't he, who's thinking, I used to be able to do this and do this well, and it's just not happening for me.
Well, you know, when you're in your prime, it just comes naturally. You train, you go in the gym, and then you get in the ring, and it just all happens. It just all comes out. And at stages in your career like this, you've got to try and remember it, think about it, make it happen.
Honey doesn't want to hang around really on the ropes, needs to get out of there. That right hand gets through. That's better from Ayers. First time he's really timing, and again, is he just starting to get to Honey? Maybe. Just looks a bit distracted at times in this round, John Honey, although that's good combination work from him. Closer round, that one.
Listen, son. That's free. You've got 9 minutes. Listen, you're letting him bully you, okay? Don't push him back,
son. Out. Round four.
In the blue trunks ahead against the comebacking Michael Ayers, who tells us he wishes to be billed now out of Ealing, West London. Don't know what the tooting popular front are going to make of that. Still one or two blemishes by the right eye of Ayers as well. I think a big question here is whether Honey can retain the self-belief and confidence. Again, he picks off Ayers, who frankly just looks a shadow of the fighter he once was. Unkind to say, but it's the truth.
Well, that is true, Ian. Remember seeing Steve Robinson, the good featherweight in the ring a few years ago, and when he just didn't have it, he just, you know, in a fight that he should have really been far too much of his opponent, just didn't have it, he retired after that one.
You do hear one or two stories that go around the business, and I might be being unkind to Michael Ayers, but there are one or two stories that he hasn't always looked after his money so well, and that's why he has to keep coming back again. And really, he should be healthy and wealthy and retired by now, having served the sport very, very well. Good left hand from Honey there.
Yeah, he's just got the counters, he's got the style to upset Ayers here, Honey.
Hasn't got any power, though. Never scored a knockout win in his whole career of 14 pro fights, John Honey, so he has to do it with the skills, of which he has a few.
Well, he's keeping himself together quite well, Honey. Looking for the counters, moving when he has to. Realise he's got the extra speed, it's just, can he keep it going?
Speed and movement, just switching the angles, and Ayers at the moment doesn't look as if he has too many ideas about what to do about it.
Hands up again.
Just doesn't look fast enough, does he, to cope with this at the moment?
He doesn't, and I must say, a fellow fighter, and knowing Michael quite well, it's pretty sad to see him at this end of his career in a sixth round of being soundly outboxed.
Because he's a proud fighter, Michael Ayers, and he was one of my favourites to watch. Great fights with Wayne Rigby. Should he be in there at all at the age of 38? Again, just no timing at all from Ayers.
No timing, no accuracy.
It's a good effort, this, though. Don't take anything away from John Honey. It's a fair old effort from him. And he's won that round again. There's only 6 minutes to go in this. Glenn's card has all four rounds to Honey. I've got it three rounds to Honey, one even. So Ayers needs something very, very dramatic here now. We think, anyway.
Well, he's got the punch. And we know Honey at times hasn't been able to take a punch. So really, he needs to find the big shot, Michael Ayers.
Can he dig up something from the memory bank? Show us a bit of that old championship quality.
Well, no disrespect to John Honey, but it's one thing losing to Pablo Sarmiento, it's a very different thing losing to Honey.
And remember, Ayers had previously beaten Sarmiento, stopped him in six rounds. That's a good uppercut from an increasingly confident John Honey, who could be well on the way here to the win of his career. And now, I think he really does believe it.
He does, he's full of confidence, he's letting the shots go, he looks strong and picking his shots well. And unfortunately, poor Michael Ayers just can't find any answers whatsoever.
It's sad, isn't it, Ben?
It is sad, it really is. See such a good fighter like Ayers at 38, coming back.
There's a look about him that tells you he's almost finding it sad himself.
Yeah. Well, you hit the nail on the head. This is a proud man.
Yeah.
He's a little right there from Ayers.
Another lowish looking blow, but the referee's saying stop complaining to Honey. He thought it was okay, get on with it. Now then, Ayers might just see that as a little invitation to come forward. He did get in with a couple there. Keep the punches up.
Well, he's doing better in this round here, as he seems to have hurt Honey a little bit with a body shot.
Just getting closer, Ayers. Now, can he start to let go some of that power? He can definitely hurt Honey, who, remember, has been beaten in the first round a few times in his career. If only he can find something like his old timing and snap. That's a very well-picked left hand from Honey again.
been pretty aggressive, and he's trying hard. Here is Honey of Thames, looks to be taking a bit of a respite in this round.
And he's covered a few miles in there, keeping away from Ayers. He's done it well, but that was a better round for Ayers, that one.
Seconds out, six, and last round.
Michael Ayers could be on his way to a shock defeat as he returns to the ring, or would it be that much of a shock at the age of 38? Ask yourself that. He's in the black trunks. Honey's boxed well, but sometimes has seen a little bit distracted. And he has moaned a few times to the referee about low blows, some real, some imagined.
Two good counters there from Honey. And Ayers just walking onto those shots, and again, just cannot get out of the way of that left hand.
See, these are the things that the fighters lose with age. Speed and reflex, and to some extent, punch resistance as well. Damaged by the right eye as well, Ayers. He needs something pretty big, I think, Ayers. Still not an awful lot coming from the old champion. It's a bit better from him.
Yeah, he's trying to get the shots off. He's getting a bit too close to Honey. He can't land with close shots, spoiling some of his own work.
His timing has been absolutely awful tonight, Ayers. I think he'd be the first to admit it.
Well, at 38, he hasn't got the time to take and getting the timing back. Really needs just to get in the fight straight away, and on this form, that's not going to happen.
Right hand from Ayers that time. But it's just one shot. Nice clean left hand again from Honey. It's been a good display, this, from him. This is a bloke who's lost more than he's won in his career, remember that.
Well, he's performed well this evening, Honey, and I think he's on the way to a real name victory.
If there's any justice, of course. Not guaranteed from recent evidence. Ah, it's another right hand, and that's what Ayers that time. The man with no kind of punch, or so his record said, certainly shook Michael Ayers there.
Well, I think this is definitely the end of the road for Michael Ayers, or it certainly should be.
It's all over, and Honey has won it, and there's no disputing that at all. The right man gets the decision, biggest win of his career, and I think Michael Ayers really does, sad to say, have to hang up the gloves for good now. There's no point in carrying on, is there?
None whatsoever. I'm sure he'll be the first to admit there's nothing there. He just didn't have it. Beaten soundly by John Honey in the last round. You're really badly hurt by someone who's never caused a stoppage in his career.
Well, there it is. Sort of a hook come uppercut. And I thought he was going to go down.
Well, it looked like it. The left balance there comes back well with a shot. Look at him stumbling against the... stumbling backwards, and it's a bad sight to see. At 38, Michael Ayers really needs to think about and hang up the gloves.
Because he's been a very good fighter, and we'll all take our hats off to everything he's done in the ring, but really for his own good, it really is time for him to call it a day. But well done to John Honney, who did the job well.
Ladies and gentlemen, after six rounds of boxing, referee Di Morgan has scored the contest for Ayers, 56 points, for Honey, 59 points. Your winner from Basingstoke, John Honey.
And four rounds to one with one even to John Honey. No exaggeration of his superiority.
Yeah, 38, I don't feel like I just seemed like the other day. But they say fighters are last to know, but I've been doing a lot better in the gym. They cut this to six rounds, I would have been better with eight rounds, but there's no excuses. John done a good job and I didn't do a good job tonight.
So you'll carry on?
The thing is, I mean, I feel I'm very unfulfilled still. I've done great things for Sky Television. I shouldn't have had the year off that I did. I'm not getting any younger, maybe the fighters are last to know, but I've got good people advising me. But I'm still there with the game. I still think I've got more to offer. I believe I can regain my form. What I won't do after this loss, I'll either retire or I will come back and fight. I just imagine I'll come back and fight and I won't be doing what I've done last time. I won't be basking in past glory.
Well, we hope you make the right decision.
Thank you very much.
John Honey's night. Michael Ayers' nights were long ago, weren't they?
Yeah, I think they were. I 5 years ago he looked terrible in a couple of fights. Roger Sampson, Anthony Maynard, came back and boxed brilliantly. I can't see him doing it again at 38. You know, and he's got to admit when he watches that, his defence was appalling. John Honey, with all due respect, is a good fighter, but he's not top class. And, Michael Ayers surely must realise now is the time to give up.
At the age of 38, 29-year-old cruiserweight returned to action after a long, long absence tonight. Kelly Oliver, away for almost 3 years in all, but he has beaten the veteran Tony Booth on points here in a four-rounder, and let's hope it's the start of a fine comeback for him. Our top of the bill here in Plymouth tonight, light welterweight, Ted Bami, Samuel Malinga, round three.
He's trying quite a lot of leather now, Malinga, but he's missing a heck of a lot, you know, Glenn.
Yes, he is. He's trying very hard, not that much getting through, but Bami needs to keep his work rate up because he's not throwing that.
Oh! What about right hand, good night.
And you just had to look where the left hand was. It was down below his shoulder, very low. We see it there, he throws the jab, drops his left hand, wide open for the right.
That's a technical fault, isn't it? He was on his feet, he tried to protest, but I don't think there's any doubt about it. John Curl got that right. Bami was poleaxed by that. Look at the way he's stumbling towards the corner as if to confirm that the referee was spot on.
Let's hope Bami can come back from that one. Our next boxing, Fernando Vargas returns to the ring at light middleweight. So exciting. It's Vargas against Fitz van der Poel, top of the bill from Los Angeles. Also Manny Pacquiao against Emmanuel Lucero for the IBF World Super Bantamweight title. That's all Sunday, 1:30 on Sky Sports 3. Hope very much you've enjoyed a fascinating night of action here in Plymouth. From Nicky and myself, it's goodbye, and we'll see you with Fernando Vargas next.